So anyhow, GLB started in October of 1955. And, you know, in those days, A, everybody was scared to death anybody would find out they were a lesbian. Secondly, there was no way to advertise that you had this organization. You couldn't put anything in the newspapers. I mean, every time anybody tried it, they kept saying this is a family newspaper, and we only print about rapes and things like that. After a year had gone by, and we had not managed to have more than about two or three additional members from those of us who started it, we decided we had to do something. And so we decided, one, we would have what we called a series of public discussion meetings, which were held in the downtown auditorium. And the idea was to allow LGBT people, if they wanted to come and listen, and they could pretend they were the public, right? And they didn't have to get involved right away. And the second thing we decided we would do was to put out a newsletter so that people would know what was going on, other than having to call everybody on the phone. So that was how the ladder got started. It got named and so on because one of our members, whose name was Brian O'Brien, also known as Bob, made a drawing. And she had the city of San Francisco in the clouds, and she had a ladder going up into the clouds, and little lesbians climbing up the ladder. So that seemed like a neat idea. So that's what we did. We used that as a cover. And for the first year, that's the only picture we did have. We changed colors, but it was still that little climbing up the ladder, which really annoyed a lot of people who came into the organization later. But that was too bad. So our first issue, we printed on the Mattachine Society's mimeograph. Some of you may remember mimeographs, but anyway. And we managed to get about 180 copies out before the machine died. It didn't actually die because we put some more out, but it crashed for that time. And that was just a process of putting, but anyhow, you put something on the machine and push the button and stuff came out instead. And you gave each page and you put it all together. And I think the first issue was about six or maybe eight pages. I forgot to count when I was looking at it. Here we have these magazines, and so we got all our members, our funeral members, to send copies to anybody that they knew, whether they were in, you know, anywhere. And so they did, because we didn't have a mailing list, and so we sent to all our members, and that was about it. And we were amazed at the response that we got. Nobody was expecting it, because we had a post office box at that time, and the responses came from people who were so excited about this newsletter that they could hardly stand it. And other people said, "Take me off your mailing list or else." You know? So, and that was kind of how it started. We put out another edition the next month, and so on. We charged $1 for a subscription. Cover the postage. $1 a year.
Yeah,
$1 a year. Things were different. So that's about the beginning of the library. I was the first editor, and the idea we weren't afraid to use our real names, Bill and I. In fact, in the first edition, our phone number and address were also in it because we were having a Halloween party, the GLB Halloween party. But I felt nervous about having my name on this magazine, which was going to go thought, you know, out everywhere. And one of my parents saw it, so I took a pseudonym of Anne Ferguson, which was one of the other things I did. And after four issues, you know, public discussion meetings, and people would come to them and they would want to meet the editor. And somebody would yell, Anne, and somebody would yell, Anne, and finally somebody would say, Phyllis, and I turned around. So in the fourth issue, we ran little boxes in Anne Ferguson is dead. And we didn't fuss around with that kind of thing. We always told people if you could use this, a pseudonym, use one that you're familiar with. I had taken my middle name and my mother's maiden name, and that didn't make much difference. And we did some very interesting things, I've always thought. I thought I was supposed to do the first two issues or something. In the second issue, we decided to send a copy to every woman attorney listed in the phone book. It did not dawn on us that this might upset some people. As a matter of fact, it upset a whole lot of people. You know, one person said, take my name off your mailing list or I'll report you to the postal authorities. But we got one taker out of the whole bunch who was not a lesbian, and that was Juliet Lowenthal, who with her husband Morris were a team of attorneys who were very busy helping out in cases involving the gay community. So, okay. But really, it took us years before we realized what a shock it must have been to those women opening this envelope in their office.
One of the things that I guess the early issues we dealt with allaying fear as much as possible. And in the third issue, we ran a column about citizens' rights in case of arrest. The attorney Benjamin Davis, who spoke to us and told us what to do in case of arrest. So there was a long article about that. But how that happened was there had been a bar raid, and a lot of people, the police just walked in, grabbed everybody, took them away, and what he told us to do, if anybody, talked to us, about it was to have them say no contest, they were there. And a lot of people most everybody was pleading guilty, just feeling guilty because they were gay, and not knowing anything about having any rights. And so they all got, on the record, sometimes it was misdemeanor account or whatever. And the fine was about $10. So they were, get out of there. But then there were some school teachers and so on that didn't go over so far. The point was made, no contest, in that you were there, but when the police took the stand, they said, what did they do? I don't know. So, what was there to charge them with? They were present, and it wasn't against the law to gather in a public place. So, as simple as that.